Fiona from Lytham.
Hello, Scotty McClure.
Hello, darling. How are you?
Oh, not too bad. I just wanted to give you a few experiences of my life in Manchester during the last war.
Thank you.
It was a hectic time.
Yes.
And it was really dreadful. I wouldn't like to go through it again.
Well, hopefully you won't have to.
We were bombed. We had the bugle bells. We had the landmines.
Was this in Lytham?
Pardon?
In Lytham?
No, I lived in Manchester all through the last war.
Oh, in Manchester, love.
Yes, I lived in Manchester. My father worked at Metro Vicks in the Trafford Park, you see.
Where, darling? Metro Vickers?
Metro Vickers.
Metro Vickers. Do you know they were the first shareholders in the British Bottom Cream?
Really?
Metro Vickers, yeah. Trafford Park, Manchester.
Well, he was there. He was transferred to Manchester, so we all moved there, you see.
They'd got 10,000 quid in the British Bottom Cream when it started.
Yes, and I worked in Trafford Park myself. And we got bombed there. We were down the shelter at work. And when we were coming on out of the night shift, going on to the night shift, we were in and out of shelters before we could get to work. And then we came off the late shift. We were in and out of shelters to get home.
So was this in the old Anderson shelter?
Well, yes. And they had shelters in different places.
They had public shelters as well.
You had your own shelter in your own.
You had your own shelter in your garden, though.
Yes, and then there were shelters round about in various places on the road, sort of thing. And you had to dodge into those on your way back home. We used to cycle, you see. Cycle home, get off the bike when the sirens went into a shelter before you got home.
And tell me this, were the shelters bomb-proof?
Well, they're supposed to be. We didn't have a direct hit in ours, luckily. But some got direct hits and they were killed, of course.
In the shelter?
Yes, so they couldn't have been.
So they weren't all that good, were they?
Well, no. If you got a direct hit, if you didn't get a direct hit, you had a better chance.
If you got a bomb near and all the fallout from it hit the shelter, the corrugated iron.
That's right. If you got a direct hit right on, you'd had it, sort of thing.
It was end of story, love. But then if your house got one, then it was end of story too, wasn't it?
Yes. And this, you see, the thing was, when you came off the night shift, you'd get to the top of your road where you lived, you'd look down from the top of the road to see if your house was still there.
Oh, my God.
And your parents, you'd left your parents to go on the night shift, and your sister, I had a sister live there when I was a young girl.
And were you doing munitions or something?
Well, no, it wasn't that. It was in the food department.
The food, right. Okay, don't say too much in case it's still secret.
We were feeding the troops.
Powdered milk and dried egg.
Well, something like that. I won't give that breath away, as you say. But it was really hectic. It wasn't all less than what people think by any means, Scott. Talk about a stressful existence. They say they're stressed out today, but by God, you got stressed out there.
You must have got no sleep, love.
Well, you didn't, Patty. And do you know what? We were tired all the 6 years of the war there. You're always tired. You're tired out all the time. We worked long hours.
I know the feeling, love.
Yeah, we worked long hours. You know, they're all long hours.
Mm.
And do you know what? If I'd have had my way, I wouldn't have worked those hours like I did. Because now, I can't go out at night because of vandals, etc. I've been burgled. And this is not a better country, Scotty.
It's a piece of damn nonsense, that, you know.
We fought for freedom, and what freedom have we got?
You should be able to go out and dance in the streets and leave your house and everything, because you're the lady who served her country.
Well, I'm 82, Scotty.
Fantastic.
And I'd like to go out, but I don't. I left my husband a while back, and I'm on my own now. Mm. But you see, you don't go out on your own now.
So you were born in 1915, then?
1917. Yeah.
Sorry, what am I doing? My arithmetic's dreadful, I apologise.
Very good. And you see, my father was in the First World War when I was born.
Yes.
In 1917, in one of those places where they were in the First War. He served in all those terrible places.
It was in Ypres, or the Somme, or Vimy Ridge.
Yes, he was in all those. And in the Second War, my husband was abroad in North Africa, Italy. I didn't see him for 6 years, Scotty.
Was he in Salerno?
Yes, he was all over the place. You never knew where they were, whether they were dead or alive. You got no information, Scotty.
And when did you marry then?
Pardon?
When did you get married?
45, when he came out.
Right.
And you had to get your rations to get the clothes to get married in. All your family put together to put the rations.
They gave you the little coupons, they snipped them, didn't they?
Yes.
Little paper coupons, little white ones.
That's right, yes. You're talking about the armed forces, etc. But you didn't mention the women of Manchester, like a generation of women. They had their lives taken away from them, Scotty, their young lives. I was 21 in August, in 39, when the war started in September.
Mm.
So that was a nice birthday present.
Gosh.
And the women that served in Manchester, the Manchurian women, they're lovely people then, Scotty. I suppose they are now.
They still are lovely people.
Well, I'm out of touch now, but when I worked there, they were fantastic ladies.
The Manchester ladies are still fantastic ladies, and the Liverpool and Leicester and Nottingham ladies.
All their men were in the forces, nearly, and about 600 in the place I worked, and all the ladies were, the men were in the forces.
But a lot of them did naughty one-two buckle my shoes as well.
Scotty.
Didn't they?
There's only a certain, they weren't all like that. There's only a certain fraction of them were like that. In this place where I work, we had them spotted, the girls that were like that.
They were a little bit on the loose side.
And they used to talk about them, you know, oh, she's off to Blackpool with so-and-so. Now, the girls, the decent, what we call them in those days, you know, the decent women, I was engaged to my husband, you know, he was my young man then. And they were pretty engaged, and they didn't go off with the men, Pet Scotty.
But listen, tell me this. How come nowadays you can't do the old, she's not decent because she drops her drawers? Why don't we go back to what we had with you a lot?
It's true.
You say, oh, she's a dirty midden her, she drops her drawers.
Well, you see, the trouble is this, the children, the brothers.
You see, you lot actually controlled yourselves, if you like, with your proper behaviour.
I was a virgin when I was married.
Is that right, love?
And that's the truth.
Fantastic.
I mean, they could have gone messing around.
Hey, I'm gonna give you the clap for that, love, because that's fantastic.
What are these kids that haven't going to be like?
I've given you the clap there, love, for hanging on to your cherry.
Yeah, well, they're going to run the country, but what are they going to be like?
You're a credit to this country. You should be able to go out any time.
Well, it's very sad, isn't it?
I've a good idea to start a squad of big lads that can go and escort somebody like yourself. Say, where would you like to go tonight, madam? Link your hand in mine and we shall walk proudly down the street to the bingo.
Well, that would be lovely, Scotty.
That's what we need, a squad of big lads there to say, anybody that touches you, my dear, don't worry about that.
Another thing, Scotty, with me having been burgled, I'm scared to death now, you know.
That's ridiculous, I do. Can I actually apologise on behalf of the badly behaved people of this country? Well, I am so sorry that you have been burgled.
You know, Scotty, what happened? I fell down and broke my hip when I was out shopping. And they took me to hospital for 6 weeks when you have the hip to do, you know, smash my hip up. When I came back, I'd been burgled out of the hospital. Now, isn't that wonderful?
I'm ashamed to call myself British when I hear that, darling.
Okay, what are we going to do with these young people that are carrying on?
Well, we've got to tell them where they're going wrong and say, look, this is a lovely, wonderful, clever, delightful lady. She does not deserve this sort of nonsense. Now stop it, or I'll wallop you one. That's what we need to give them, you know.
Yeah, well, I think they ought to handcuff them, Scotty, these young chaps, so they can't let do them anything.
They ought to what, love?
Handcuff them when they go.
Handcuff them?
Yeah.
Right, you see, if you're not with your parents, you've got to have your handcuffs on at all times so that you don't dip anybody's pocket.
Well, if they can't do anything else, they could do that, couldn't they, Scotty?
That's like the days of Oliver, darling. We're back to Fagin.
We're
back to the old, I am reviewing the situation.
Scotty, another thing I don't agree with, I don't think our government are doing enough. They've no guts, have they, to stop all this that's going on. They should be stopping it so their people, we people, can live in decent.
They should be able to live in decent peace, love. I mean, it's a piece of nonsense. I mean, I'll tell you, I would go and do it myself, be an MP, but you never hear of them again once they get to London, do you?
That's it,
they've gone tatars.
I think our government are letting the British people down. I really do, and I feel very angry, Scotty, about it.
Well, so you should, because I'll tell you something. You have no need to be living in fear of anything.
Well, you
should be able to call the shots.
Scotty, in the 30s, when I was a young girl, you went out to a dance and got home at 2. You could walk home on your own.
Oh!
Any fear, and that's a fact.
You could walk home and you could take your shoes off and not stand in any dog pop.
Well, that's it, but you could walk home. Now you're looking over your shoulder. Well, I don't go out, as I've told you, but And we've got young girls. And look at the young girls. They're getting knocked around today. These men, it's terrible.
British people should always be able to go out. I think we should start perambulating again. Right, before the Scotty McClue phone-in starts at 10, the nation should all go out for a walk. It's compulsory that at, say, between 8:30 and 9:30,
that's true.
The nation perambulates and everyone says, "Hello, Mrs. Mac, come for a stroll with us."
Well, Scotty, I like your show. You're doing a marvellous job. And I remember you at Preston. I used to phone in there occasionally.
You did. And I loved having conversations with you. And it's such a privilege to know that you're still doing well.
I love this, Scotty, because you've got a lot of people, haven't you?
Well, it doesn't matter, because I'll tell you, for once in their life, these people can wait out of respect for you, darling.
Well, that's lovely of you, Scotty.
Lovely to talk to you. And may you go from strength to strength. I hope your hip gets well. And I hope the day will come when you can perambulate.
Yeah, and you too, Scotty. All the best, Scotty.
Love you, darling. Night-night.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. What a very, very sweet lady. She's out in Lytham there, and she remembers it like it is.